All right, Springdale. You look good this morning. How are we? All right, okay. Look at that energy. Come on, hey, stand up. Let's do this. Online, it's good to see you too. Hey, just turn around to somebody, give them an air fist bump, give them a wave, smile at their face. Just let them know that you see them this morning. So good, man. Thanks for making the decision to be at church. Come on, let's end 2020 strong. Let's worship together some. We've been learning this song this semester, last few months. Some great truth in this song. Come on, sing it with us. Come on online, sing it with us. Just one word, you calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. And just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that I got can do. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Just one word, you heal what's broken inside me. Just one word, you revive every dream. Just one like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of, come on, sing it. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like to us from Psalm 95. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Come on, man, this is scripture. Let us come together. Let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Some of you are going, I can't sing. but I can make the joyful noise. That's all I got. That's okay. Both are included. You don't have to just sing. You can just make a joyful noise. But come on, let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. The solid God of the universe is our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. We have much to be thankful for. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. And on Psalm 95 goes. It's one of my favorite. We have a reason to worship God this morning. He is the great rock of our salvation. He is all powerful. Come on, let's sing to him this morning.
Jesus, you are. working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper. will trust with all that I am. Sing Jesus.
Further in our service this morning, can we just stop for a minute and just give you a chance to just talk to the Lord? I know the holiday season sometimes is crazy. We're out of our routine. Maybe some of you haven't even just stopped and just talked to the Lord in several days. And I just want to be quiet for a minute and give you a chance to talk to him and just share your heart with him and say, Lord, this is where I need you right now for this next year in my life. I need you blank. Just tell him this morning. God, we trust you in all things and in all ways. Even in those moments where it's really hard to trust because things look really bad, or we can't see the outcome, or we're not sure that we know you're near. Lord, in all those moments, we just remember the truth of who you are. We remember that the Word of God calls you a faithful God. You're not the sand of our salvation. You are the rock of our salvation. And you're worthy of our praise because you are a solid foundation that we can put our hope in, we can put our trust in. And Lord, when we need you, we know that you are near. And I pray this morning that you would be near to us in this place in a special way, that you would manifest yourself in a way that is new and fresh, move in the hearts of your people today. For the sake of the gospel, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You guys can be seated. Thanks so much for being here today. Man, I hope you came ready and excited to meet with the Lord the last Sunday of 2020. I've been tempted to think about this Sunday as, let's just hurry up and get through it so we can get to the new year, right? Some of us kind of have that mentality. And the Lord this morning was like, listen, this year has been a crazy one. But you have one more chance in 2020, in the midst of the crazy, to tell me how great I am. Don't miss out on that. And I hope this morning that you have chosen to praise the Lord with us. And I pray in a moment when we open up the Word of God and study the Word of God that you'll make a conscious choice this morning to let the Lord speak to you powerfully through the truth of His Word one more time on a Sunday morning in 2020. Let this be a powerful moment between you and the Lord today. Also, we have one more opportunity, one more Sunday opportunity to give of our tithes and our offerings, which is also an act of worship. I pray that we would worship the Lord this morning by the giving of our tithes and our offerings. If you didn't bring it today, our business office will be open this week all the way through the end of the year. You can bring that up if you want to give any year-end gifts. Our offices will be open for you to come give at the end of the year as you continue to worship even throughout the week. So let's pray together and we'll turn our attention to the screens. God, we do worship you in all aspects of this service, in all aspects of our life. It is all yours. It all belongs to you. We give it to you freely. In the name of Jesus, I'm able to pray. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to Cross Church. The new year is a great time to refocus. Many people refocus on diet and exercise, on time management and priorities. 21 Days of Prayer is a call to refocus our lives on God, to seek His power and presence in our lives in church. It's an intentional time of prayer, and many people include fasting during 21 Days of Prayer. Fasting is giving something up, often food, as a reminder that you need God more than that thing. Check out ways you can fast and other information about 21 days at crosschurch.com/21days. Our mission at Cross Church is to reach Northwest Arkansas, America, and the world for Jesus Christ. Thank you for believing in that mission through your generosity. Because of your faithfulness, we have seen God work in our church and through you, our members. One of the greatest joys we have is to hear of how God is working in and through you. Listen to how God has worked through one of our small group leaders this year.
Hey y'all, I'm Josh Howard. I transferred to the University of Arkansas my sophomore year of college, and I sought out a godly community, and I found that in C3, Cross Church College Ministry. Ended up being involved in the international ministry as well, and through that, God was working on my heart, calling me to long-term missions. In June, I started at The Porch, was able to immediately jump into an awesome role as a small group leader, was able to pour into all the guys in my small group, grow in relationship with them. I met three guys specifically who I got to meet up with one-on-one. We were able to talk through the truth of who God is, what he's done, and those three guys were saved this year. So praise God for that. I'm just incredibly grateful for just these last few years with Cross Church, that paired with seminary in my preparation. I pray that God would use that to equip me for the international mission field. Thank you so much, Cross Church. God has used you specifically to invest in people like me. I'm so grateful for you. I just want to say thank you.
Church, lives are being changed and people are being used because of your faithfulness. So thank you so much. Let's all finish strong and consider a special year-end gift to reach more people for Jesus Christ. Your year-end gift positions us to see God move in even greater ways in 2021. We are looking forward to the power of God coming this year. We hope you have a happy new year. Thanks for worshiping with us today at Cross Church.
Well, amen. How's everyone doing this morning? Good, good. Hey, I want to welcome you here at our Springdale campus. I also want to welcome all of you that are worshiping with us online today. We know that even on today, we have thousands of people worshiping with us online today. So thank you for joining us today. You know, David said it a few moments ago, for many people, 2020 will be the year that they say, just hurry up and get it over with, right? I thought about it this way, 2020, this year became an adjective in most people's lives. When you think about it, people use the term 2020 to now describe when someone goes crazy. And they say things like, hey, why are you acting so 2020 towards me? Or someone cuts you off in traffic and said, don't you cut me off, I will 2020 you. That is how most people have kind of viewed the end of this year. But I believe with David that there may be one more moment that God has for us. And I don't want us to miss that moment today. I don't want us to miss the moment. And you know, 2020, with all the changes and all that we faced and all that we've gone through, and you know, I was looking the other day, do you realize how many masks I have bought in 2020? If you're like me, I have a whole drawer of masks I have tried in 2020. And the truth is this, no matter what has happened to us in 2020, no matter what we've experienced in our life, because some of us in our life, we've experienced some amazing brokenness. God has the power to move us from brokenness to a breakthrough. And I want to give you a good word today. Like if you came into this room just super heavy, or you're watching online and you're like, man, I'm so done with this year. I just want to tell you, no matter what has happened to you this year, there is a God who loves you enough that he's able to take you from a place of brokenness and bring new breakthrough into your life, because he is a God of grace. Can I get an amen? He is. If you have your Bible, turn to the book of Luke chapter 7. Luke chapter 7. And if you have a pen, I want you to take notes today, because I think there's three things that we're going to learn today about how God can take our brokenness and how he can turn it into breakthrough. You know, I'm excited because as I look towards 2021, I don't want to talk a lot about what happened in 2020. If you're like me, I'm a future thinker. I want to think about what is in tomorrow for me. And the greatest question won't be what happened to me in 2020. The greatest question that you and I will answer is this: how will I respond to Jesus? In fact, I want you to take that question and think of it like the center console of the dashboard of your car. There are certain lights that when they come on, they tell you certain things are happening in your car. But when the light comes on in 2021, the question of that light will probably be the most important question that will define our tomorrow. How will I and how will you respond to Jesus? How do we respond to Jesus? We're about to enter into 21 days of prayer and fasting. And when I think about that, I get excited because when God brings us to a place where he slows us down a little bit and he focuses our heart toward him in prayer and in fasting, setting aside something so that we can spend more time with him, there's always seems to be a way that God uses that to position us for a breakthrough in our life. So today we're gonna look at a story of a woman and a man who encountered Jesus and how God moved her from brokenness to breakthrough. And then we're gonna talk about three things that we learned from that passage. Luke chapter 7, beginning with verse 36. Listen to what the Bible says. It says, when one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house and he reclined at the table. And a woman in that town who had lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. So she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. And as she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. And then she wiped them with her hair and she kissed them and poured perfume on them. So I want to give you a picture of what's going on here real quick. See, there's a man named Simon. The Bible tells us he was a Pharisee. And he was holding a dinner, and then he requests Jesus, hey, Jesus, why don't you come over? We're going to have a dinner. I would love to introduce you to some of the other religious leaders and some of the more prominent people in our religious community. I want you to come over and have dinner with us. And in the midst of that, there's a woman from the city who's identified in Scripture as a sinner. We learned from Jesus all that was going to happen at this party because when she heard that Jesus was showing up at the party, she turned up at the party. She brought a jar of perfume and she began to anoint his feet and she wept and she wet his feet with her tears and she wiped his feet with her hair and then she anointed him with the perfume. In fact, in the book of Mark, this story is told in all four Gospels, by the way. In the book of Mark, it says that when she got to the feet of Jesus, she broke the bottle of perfume at the feet of Jesus. So here she was, anointing him with the perfume. You see, typically when you would invite a rabbi to come to a party, it was so that you could hear the rabbi speak. And so they had invited Jesus because they wanted to hear what Jesus had to say. And in this moment, what they realized is that Jesus had a lot to say to them. And when they would call these parties together, it wasn't like a private room at a restaurant, like you think of a closed ballroom. It would have been like an open courtyard area. And so as Jesus and Simon and all of them gathered around, there would have been other people that would have probably, knowing that Jesus was near, would have probably gathered around to just kind of lean in and listen a little bit. And so although this woman wasn't invited, she shows up. And here's the crazy thing. Everyone knew she was a sinner. I mean, have you ever been to a party before and that person showed up? She was that person. Like some of you, like if you came to church on a Sunday morning and like the craziest person on the earth showed up to church, that would like freak you out, okay? That's the moment they're having. What in the world is she doing here? She had a bad reputation around town. In fact, many biblical scholars assume that she was likely a prostitute, a woman that had really questionable morals. And the perfume she had was extremely expensive. In fact, in one of the Gospels, it asked the question, why would you waste this? In other words, hey, lady, you could have taken that perfume and given it for us here at the temple. We could have had more temple tax. It probably would have cost her about a year's wages. And possibly, it may have even been a family heirloom. But whatever it was, here's what I know. It was an extravagant act of worship. Her response to Jesus was extravagant. You see, the alabaster jar was made of pure nard, a perennial herb that was harvested in the Himalayas. And it was probably about a half a liter, and the jar itself was probably something that had family jewels and semi-transparent with gemstones, maybe even, you know, it could have even been her dowry that her dad would have paid to her future husband so that he would marry her. But she brings it to Jesus. But here's what's so powerful about what she brought. The jar represented her past guilt, but it also represented her future hope. I mean, think about that for a minute. This perfume, if she was a prostitute, was part of her professional identity. When you smelled that perfume, you probably knew that was her. But it also represented probably her financial security. Because if things got really, really bad, a year's worth of wages was a lot of money in those days. And yet, here's what's crazy. The woman risked it all because she believed that Jesus Christ was worth it. Isn't that a beautiful picture? I mean, how ironic is it that the very thing she may have used in her profession as a prostitute would become the very thing she used to profess her faith and trust in Jesus? That's a story of God's grace. I mean, even think about it. The act of her letting down her hair was like her being vulnerable to Jesus. Jesus, I'm willing to risk all my dignity at your feet because I know that you somehow, some way, your grace is so good that you control my destiny. So how vulnerable it would have been when she drew her hair down and she began wiping his feet. I would have loved to have been a fly on the wall and heard what was said in that moment. In fact, we find it in the other gospels, what different people said. But here's what we know about the action of this woman. Listen to this, write this down. She was moved by a realization of sin and a reception of grace. She knew what her past was, but she knew that how she responded to Jesus could change everything. Listen, I want to tell you, for whatever 2020 was or wasn't for you, for whatever good or bad or brokenness you feel or loss you have, I want to tell you there's hope for tomorrow because the grace of God is real. And Jesus Christ came to reveal to us that grace of God. And you and I, we don't have to stay broken in our lives. We'll talk about that more in a minute. But this action of the woman showed that she was moved by the realization of her sin and a reception of grace. And when I think of that, here's what I believe. You can't fully comprehend the goodness of God until you realize the depths of your brokenness. You see, that was Simon's struggle. And many times we never move past our own brokenness because we get stuck in our own self-righteousness. So look at Simon's struggle. Look at verse 39. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, now think about this. He said to himself, he whispered under his breath. He said it in his mind. I don't know, but here's what we know. He said it to himself. He didn't publicly say it, but he said it to himself. He said, if this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner. And I love what Jesus says in verse 40. Jesus answered him, Simon, I have something to tell you. Tell me, teacher, he said. He said, two people owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii, the other 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he forgave the debts of both. Which of them will love him more? Listen, one of the things I love about Jesus, and we see in Scripture all the time, Jesus always asked questions he already knew the answer to. But Jesus asked the question because he wanted to take this man on a journey to understand and see the grace of God. He said, hey, one guy had 50, another guy had a few. The man forgave both. Which one should be more grateful? Simon replied, I suppose the one who had the bigger debt forgiven. You have judged correctly, Jesus said. Wow, what a powerful statement. Remember what I said in the beginning? What will define 2021 is not what happened to us in 2020. What will define 2021 is how do we respond to Jesus? And Jesus posed a picture. He said, if a person had a huge debt that they couldn't cancel themselves, and the person that they owed the debt to forgave the debt, what should their response be to the grace of God? And Jesus said, you've judged correctly, Simon. I want to teach you about my grace. I like how Jerry Bridges says it when he talks about the grace of God. He says, we cannot exercise love unless we are experiencing grace. You cannot truly love others unless you are convinced that God's love for you is unconditional, based solely on the merit of Christ, and not on your own performance. What a powerful statement that is. One of my hero preachers in my life, Dr. Tony Evans, he says it this way. He said, the folk who love God the most and worship him the most are the folk who recognize the pit from which they've been rescued. They recognize the greatness of grace. You show me a man or a woman who understands grace, and I'll show you a worshiper. If you don't have a desperate need of God, you can't worship him deeply. You see, her response to Jesus and Jesus' response to her tells us something. Even though we come broken, when we waste ourselves at the feet of Jesus, we can experience breakthrough. I can't help but think that every time someone would smell that scent from now on, they thought of that woman. You see, sometimes what we really need is just a reality check of our own brokenness. I meet a lot of people, they go, well, man, at least I'm not as bad as that person. Don't look at the person next to you. Some of you go, I'm not as bad as her. I don't treat people the way he does. Isn't it funny how we rank sin? How we rank brokenness? Oh, that person's way more broken than I am. I mean, I got these issues in my life, but that person has these issues in their life. And we kind of look at it like, you know, somehow we only need a measure of grace that fits the measure of brokenness. Can I tell you that apart from Jesus, we're broken? But because of the grace of God, we don't have to stay that way. And sometimes we just need a realization that I'm not as good as I think I am. We also need a realization because of the gospel, I'm not as bad as I think I am. Both are true. And so if you catch yourself with this type of thought process that says, hey, I'm just not that bad, what can happen is that you may miss out on the moment of worship like this woman had. Imagine all the people around hearing the glass break, smelling the aroma. Jesus is there and you hear her weeping. And in her weeping, she's worshiping. I mean, I always, without giving conjecture, I always try to put myself into that moment when I read that in scripture. You know, maybe she was weeping and she's singing, Jesus. Maybe she's singing these words. Waymaker, miracle worker, light in the darkness. I don't know. Whatever it was she was singing and whatever it was she was weeping, she was worshiping. And I want to say this to you today. Whatever 2020 has brought your way, it will never be as great as it means to worship at the feet of Jesus. Watchman Nee, an old missionary guy, he said this one time. He said, a life is never wasted that's wasted at the feet of Jesus. The older I get, the more I think about the opportunities God has given me, none of it's wasted. So I want to make this statement to you today. As you launch into 2020, I hope this gives you great hope. When we bring our brokenness to the feet of Jesus, we are in the right position to experience a breakthrough in our lives. When we come to the point that all we can do is kneel at his feet and wet his feet with our tears, we are actually in the greatest position to experience breakthrough in our life. The Bible tells us that. The Bible tells us that he doesn't despise our brokenness. He comes and he meets us in our brokenness. Isaiah 61 tells us that when Jesus, it was said that he was going to come and that he would be Messiah, that he would be the one that come to set the captives free. So I have great hope today that when I bring my brokenness to the feet of Jesus, I'm actually in the best position I could possibly be in to experience breakthrough. But I want you to look at Jesus' response. Verse 44, then he turned to the woman, and he said to Simon, do you see this woman? He says, I came into your house and you didn't give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You didn't give me a kiss, but this woman from the time I entered has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she's poured perfume on my feet. Look at verse 47. This is so good. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, her many sins have been forgiven, and as her great love has shown, but whoever has been forgiven little loves little. Then Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven. The other guests began to say among themselves, who is this who even forgives sin? Jesus said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Wow, what a powerful moment. You got one more moment left in 2020. What would it look like for you and I to spend that moment at the feet of Jesus? What would it look like? You know, there's three things I want us to pull out of this text today that we need to walk away and apply. The first one is this. Worship is always the right response to the grace of God. Worship is always the right response to the grace of God. You show me someone who has experienced the grace of God in their life, I'll show you a worshiper. They don't worship their problems, they worship a risen Savior, and Jesus is alive in them. And I want to tell you today, you know, maybe you're watching online, maybe you're here at this campus, and you're thinking, man, my life feels empty at the end of 2020. It doesn't have to stay that way. God wants to bring you to a place of worship, and the way you get to that place of worship is by experiencing His grace, not your grind. Not your struggle. I mean, some of us this year, we haven't just been on the struggle bus, we drove the struggle bus. Why don't you pull the struggle bus over on this last Sunday of 2020? Get out of the struggle bus and get at the feet of Jesus and get in the right position and worship. Because listen, you can worry your problems or you can worship through your problems. That's the choice we get. Worship is always the response that is right to the grace of God. If you want to know how am I responding to Jesus, ask yourself, how am I worshiping? I'm not just talking about singing a song. I'm talking about everywhere you go, you have the opportunity to worship. Yes. Number two, Jesus is attracted to our brokenness, but he's committed to our wholeness. You see, I've met a lot of people, their badge of courage is all the things they did wrong in their life. Therefore, that must have made them ready for the grace of God. I used to work with students all the time, and many students who grew up in the church would say to me, they'd say, well, Sean, I don't really have a good testimony because I never robbed a bank or stole anything or shot anyone or kicked my neighbor's cat. And I just looked at them and I go, wow, is that what you think? God is always attracted to our brokenness because in our brokenness, we get vulnerable to him. But folks, I want to tell you the most amazing thing today. He's committed to our wholeness. Jesus didn't leave this woman in the state she was in. He didn't leave her in her brokenness. I know we read in the top of our Bibles, you know, like my Bible says, Jesus anointed by a sinful woman. But I promise you, when I see this woman in heaven, I won't say, oh, there's the sinful woman that anointed Jesus. I'll go, there is that crazy worshiper of Jesus. She loved him well. Why? Because God's attracted to our brokenness, but because of Jesus, he's committed to our wholeness. I want to tell you today, whatever you're facing today, Jesus wants to make you whole. You say, well, can he fix all my problems? He could do all that, but you know what he cares more about? Fixing you. I mean, what if the very problems we're facing is the very thing God wants to use to just fix us? Some of you go, well, I don't like that. Because I tell you, God is so committed to your wholeness, he will look for nothing less than you and I becoming just like Jesus. That brings me hope today. Verse 47, it tells us this. It says, therefore, I tell you, her sins have been forgiven as great as her love has shown. Her love was a sign that she had experienced the grace of God. Can I tell you today, to our community, to our world, our love is a sign that we have experienced the grace of God. The decade of love is here. The decade of love is here. It is time to love people. It is time to love them where they are because God wants to lead them somewhere differently. He wants to set people. Listen, Jesus is still setting people free. Oh, I'm so grateful the grace of God wasn't just for the day that I bowed my knee and asked him to come into my life. Did you know I'm an avid user? Every day, the power and the need for God's grace. So amazing. You know what I love about that too? That Jesus is so committed to our wholeness. The Bible tells us in all the other gospels other than Luke, listen to what Mark 14:9 says. Therefore, truly I tell you, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her. Jesus wanted us to hear that. Why? Because he wanted us to talk about this woman who went from being broken, who experienced breakthrough, and now she's made whole. That ought to give us hope. That gives me hope today. The third thing that I think can help us move from brokenness to breakthrough in our life is this, is that Jesus alone has the power to forgive sin. Think of this moment, all the religious leaders, you know, they had all their laws, 600 and something laws, they were trying to do it right, they were trying to be right, they were trying to look good in front of each other, they were trying to impress one another, they were trying to be, they were so good at being religious, but they missed the grace of God. In the midst of all that, Jesus makes this statement, woman, your sins are forgiven. I mean, imagine the Pharisees, whoa, 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 I didn't see anyone go into the temple. I didn't see anyone make sacrifice. Who slaughtered another goat? Who slaughtered another bull? How is this woman gonna... Jesus spoke to her and said, woman, your sins are forgiven. Why does that give us hope for 2021? Because no matter what we face, you and I can walk in fullness because through Jesus, we walk in forgiveness. I don't have to do anything to earn his love. Listen, I know there's gonna be lots of ads to join a gym. Weight Watchers, is gonna tell you how many points. All it takes is this much. Jenny Craig's gonna sell you a meal. All these different people are gonna say, if you make this one decision and if you just try just a little bit, and listen, I'm all for those things because I think those things can help us. But I wanna tell you, the one question that nobody is asking that we need to start asking that can change all of 2021 is this: how will you and I respond to Jesus? Because Jesus has the power to forgive sin. We can sit and look at our world and say, our world is just messed up. Or we can say to our world, Jesus has the power to forgive sin. Jesus has the power to forgive sin. He told this woman, he said, you don't have to live this way anymore. How do we know Jesus has the power to forgive sin? Because he overcame the power of sin in our life when he died on the cross for sin. I like the way Paul says it in the book of Romans chapter 6. He says, "For sin shall not be your master, because you are not under law, you are under grace." There's the grace of God. You see, you and I have this powerful realization that if Jesus has the power to forgive sins, then everything is possible in our lives. We are no longer slaves. Now we're sons and daughters. You treat a slave one way, you treat a son and a daughter another way. I guarantee you, my son's here today. If he said, "Dad, I need this," I'd give him anything he wants. Why? He's my son. He is my son. Listen, you can talk about me all you want. Don't ever talk about my son, because when you talk about my son, that's my son. I feel that way as an earthly father. Imagine what your heavenly father thinks when the world says back to you, "You are nothing, you don't have it, you will never be good enough." And God looks at you and says, no, you don't understand. You're not a slave. You're a son. Jesus alone has the power to forgive sin. I like how Ravi Zacharias said it. He said, "Jesus didn't come to make bad people good. He came to make dead people alive." That's the grace of God. "For it's by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no man can boast." I'm going to boast in the grace of God today. Do you know how good God is? Do you know how loving the Father is? He's not mad at you. He doesn't want to pay you back. He wants to bring you back. That's why he died on a cross, so that he could redeem you from the power of sin. And so when Jesus made this statement, he ultimately sealed the idea that I don't have to stay broken. As you reflect on 2020, don't define it by what you did or didn't do. "Well, I didn't get to go on a vacation. Well, I learned how to wear a mask. Well, I made it through Walmart without only touching two things." Maybe we should measure 2020 by what we became. We have one Sunday to sit at his feet and worship, surrender to him, worship him, put our focus on him. We become more thankful for the grace of God in our life, more dependent on his grace. And I was so self-dependent in January, February, but now I've never been this more dependent on God. And God's been faithful. God's been faithful. As you begin 2021, the question is this: what will your position be? Will you be at the feet of Jesus? We're about to enter into 21 days of prayer and fasting. What if you took one thing in your life that mattered really deeply to you and you set it aside for 21 days, and the time you would normally spend doing that one thing, what if you fasted from that one thing, and that time you spent, you just spent that extra time at the feet of Jesus? I promise you, you'll come out better. You'll no longer focus on what you fasted from. You will be focused on what you're fasting for. Jesus is more than enough. And the grace of God is more than enough. You know, the grace of God changes you. I mean, I really do believe this. I think when this woman left, she was forever different. We don't know. We don't read it in Scripture. But I have to believe that the encounter she had with Jesus was forever different. The experience of the grace of God and knowing that her sins had been forgiven was forever different. It changes us. It changes you, it changes me. I'm not who I was when I was 17 and I gave my life to Jesus. And I'm not who I'm going to be 20 years from now. The grace of God is still changing my life. I think of people, when they surrender to Jesus this way, how radically different their life becomes. I read a story not too long ago about a group of missionaries called One-Way Missionaries. One of them specifically was a guy by the name of A.W. Milne. He was in the early 1900s, And these one-way missionaries, instead of packing their bags to go to the mission field, they would take a wooden coffin and they would pack all their belongings in that, because what they were saying to the world and to themselves, I'm going to die reaching these people for Jesus. And so they packed all of their stuff. He set sail, A.W. Milne, in the early 1900s for New Hebrides in the South Pacific, knowing that the headhunters there had martyred every missionary before him. Imagine getting that report. Hey, just so you know, every missionary that ever came before you has died. But he packed his coffin. And many people ask the question, how do you do that? How do you pack your coffin, knowing that you probably are not coming home? And people said this about Milne. They said, Milne never feared for his life because he had already died to himself. Maybe the greatest thing in this day is we can die to ourselves. His coffin was packed. Listen, for 35 years, he lived among that tribe and he loved them. And when he died, the tribe members buried him in the middle of their village and inscribed this epitaph on his tombstone. When he came, there was no light. And when he left, there was no darkness. Man, that's a man who experienced the grace of Jesus. So radically and profoundly changed that he was willing to die to himself. He was able to love people who didn't love him. He was able to care for those who had nothing to give him back. Why? Because he experienced forgiveness. He was worshiping at the feet of Jesus. And probably Jesus had moved him to a place of brokenness in his life, to a place of wholeness in his life. Paul said it this way. He said, I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. The life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved and gave himself for me. What position will you end 2020 in? Would you bow your heads with me today all over this room? If you're watching online, would you just take a moment, just bow your heads there where you're watching? Just silence everything around you. There's two things I want to say to you in this moment. First of all is this. If you've never experienced the grace and forgiveness of Jesus Christ, today is your opportunity. You don't have to worry about all that didn't happen in 2020. Because if today you experience the grace of Jesus Christ to forgive your sin, it'll change everything that's in the rearview mirror. If that's you here today, and you say, you know what, I want to receive Christ into my life, would you just pray this prayer with me? Just say, Jesus, I need you. I know that I've sinned. I know that I haven't always done what you've called me to do. But Jesus, I know that you have the power to forgive sin. Jesus, would you come into my life? Forgive me of sin. I turn from my sin. And Jesus, I turn wholeheartedly to you. Jesus, change me by your grace. There's another group of people here today. And I want to say the second thing to you. I want you to reframe the grace of God today. I want you to think about yourself at the end of this year at the feet of Jesus, worshiping him for who he is, for what he's done, for what he's about to do, for what you and I could never do. Everything that was against us, Jesus is now for us. Nothing can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. So I want to speak a word of hope over you today. Hope isn't lost. Hope is found in the grace of God. Let me tell you how God's going to heal you in 2021. He's going to heal your hope. That's what I'm asking God for in my life. God, I want you to heal my hope. I want to believe you for things I've never believed you for. My greatest days are not behind me. My greatest days are ahead of me because the grace of God has been revealed to me through Jesus Christ. Father, today, thank you for every person that said yes to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen, today, if you're watching online, you're here in the room today, I want to tell you that if today you prayed with me just a moment ago and you received Jesus Christ into your life, you turned from sin and you turned to him as your Lord and Savior, we would love to know that. We would love to celebrate that with you today. And so on the screen, you'll see a thing that says this. It says, text your first and last name to this number, 479-343-8777. So like if I was making that decision, I would say Sean Smith to 479-343-8777. We want to celebrate with you. Listen, this year alone, hundreds and hundreds of people through a text message response have told us that they put their faith and their trust in Jesus. And so today, we just want to invite you to join the crowd in that. And then the last thing I want to say to you is this. Listen, Cross Church, we've been at this 150 years. It's about to get real good. Are you ready for the ride? Are you ready for the decade of love?
Yes.
Are you ready to see what happens when we put this crazy intention on the next generation? When we follow the obedience of Christ's command to go to all the ends of the earth, listen, the best is yet to come. Let me pray us out today. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you today for every single person that put their faith and trust in you. God, your grace is real. Your grace is amazing. God, you are amazing. And I'm so thankful that on this day, Lord, we're not looking back, we're looking forward. God, put us in the right position at the feet of Jesus, worshiping. And I pray we will experience the joy and the freedom that this woman got to experience. Lord, we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.